Welcome to the Selling from the Heart podcast on the Salescast Network. You've joined a global movement of sales professionals who are dedicated to being authentic and building trust. We call it Selling from the Heart. Together, we are on a mission to bring sincerity and substance to the sales profession we all love. Get ready to be inspired and equipped as we join our hosts, Larry Levine and Darrell Amy.
Darrell here, and I'm excited to announce that Larry's book, Selling from the Heart, has been picked up by a New York publishing house and is now available for pre-order on the barnesandnoble.com website. The movement of authenticity is gaining momentum, and it would be beneficial to have the book available not just online, but also on the shelves of Barnes & Noble stores. To make this a possibility, we would like to get pre-orders for as many copies of Selling from the Heart as possible in order to demonstrate the book's popularity. So those who pre-order the book on barnesandnoble.com are going to receive over $250 in special bonus items as a token of our gratitude for supporting this huge goal. To show your support, pre-order Selling from the Heart on barnesandnoble.com and then go to sellingfromtheheart.net/book to get access to your special bonus items. We are so grateful for your support as we continue to build this movement of authenticity in the sales profession we all love. Hello, and welcome back to the Selling from the Heart podcast. Your co-host, Darrell Amy, here today with Larry Levine. What's going on, Larry?
Another great day here in the Selling from the Heart community. We're in for a treat today. By the way, great seeing you, Darrell.
It's good to see you too. Joanne Black is in the house. This is going to be a phenomenal discussion about referrals. Just get ready. Here we are. It's hot outside if you're in the Northern Hemisphere, and it's summer and it's sizzling and it's time to stay focused and motivated. And Larry, what I absolutely love about the Selling from the Heart community is we've got a community of sales professionals and sales leaders who've said, hey, I buy into this. I believe in being genuine, being authentic, building trust. This is the definition of selling from the heart. And all summer long, we're interacting with people in the Selling from the Heart Insiders group. And I think this is such an incredible way to stay focused and fired up during the months of summer where, let's be honest, sometimes it's a little easy to get slack off a little bit.
No, it is. And we just encourage you, if you want to come hang out with some like-hearted, like-minded individuals, come check us out at the Selling from the Heart Insiders group. And we meet every Friday. You'll have a blast. And there's one special person I just want to reach out to as we get started, Darrell, and that's Hugh Hornsby. And if there's ever a sales leader out there that walks and talks and lives a Selling from the Heart lifestyle, it's Hugh Hornsby. Hugh, you're doing an amazing job leading your sales team. We appreciate you.
I second that, Hugh. You're an incredible leader and an all-around great guy. And these are the types of people we get to meet in the Selling from the Heart community. So if you want to join us for an upcoming, up close and personal, go to sellingfromtheheart.net/free-pass. We'll put that in the show notes. And you can join us and just get a taste of this incredible community of authentic sales professionals. It is going to be a massive encouragement and lift to your career. Speaking of lift to your career and encouragement and growth to sales, we got a conversation today about referrals. You're going to love it. Joanne Black is our guest. She is America's leading authority on referral selling. As the founder of No More Cold Calling, Joanne helps salespeople, sales teams, and business owners build their referral networks so they can quickly attract more businesses, decrease operating costs, and ace out the competition every time. Joanne, welcome to Selling from the Heart. It is great to have you here.
Oh, same here. Over my heart.
It's always great to see Joanne Black. Thanks for hanging out with us.
We're going to have such a fun conversation today. And Joanne, as we get started, you know the question that every guest on the Selling from the Heart podcast answers. And that is, what does it mean to you, Joanne, to sell from the heart?
It's not about me. It's never about us in sales. And that's unfortunate because most people think it is about themselves. It's always about the client. It's about the other people and being ourselves. And I think today that's harder because of all the technology and our dependence on it. So who are we? Are we proud? Are we serving? Are we seeing that anything is possible? Are we curious? All those things make up top salespeople.
Oh, this is so good. And I've enjoyed getting to know you over the years, Joanne, and following a lot of the stuff that you write. And I'm glad you brought in technology, because I get into some deep conversations around technology. And I think a lot of times we hide behind it as salespeople. Let's just face it. It's easy to hide behind technology. But if we want to bring our true versions of ourselves to the forefront, we actually have to step in front of it. And instead of all about me, I'm all about we. And we have to bring the best version of ourselves to our clients, which means we have to get to know ourselves. And to get to know ourselves, it's a journey. But I like how you brought in technology and getting to know yourself. It's something that I think a lot of salespeople and sales leaders, they must throw that mirror in front of their face if they're going to bring the best version of themselves to their clients.
No, I agree. And I say that they hide behind the technology curtain. I've said that probably for the last 7-8 years. And now it's even gotten worse, because people think that all they have to do is, you know, send a bunch of emails and have conversations on LinkedIn and okay, they're fine.
Boom, instant sales.
Yeah.
But this is a great bridge to our topic of conversation today, because you have been an advocate and expert and champion for referrals for a long time. And I'm curious what got you. You've been doing this for decades now and helping and coaching sales professionals and sales leaders around referrals. What got you passionate about referrals in the first place?
Yeah, I never thought I'd be in this business. I had worked for 2 consulting and training firms, and the last one for about 5 years. And it was 1996. So when you said decades, that's accurate. The economy is great. And my colleague said, Joanne, you should really start your own business. I thought about it and I said, well, why not? What I thought I was going to do was work with small companies to develop their sales strategy, because back then you could not find anything about sales in a business plan. Well, my first client was a small outplacement firm. And yes, they were a referral. but here's what got me to where I am now. As I was working with them, serendipitously, they were doing a customer satisfaction survey of 50 of their best clients. And it was several rounds. And for some reason, I added a question to the last round. Would you be willing to be a referral to this client? It was a 7-point scale, 7 high. Mm-hmm. Well, my question came back 6.5.
Wow.
So I couldn't wait to my next meeting with the management team. And I said that 50 of your best clients say they'd be glad to refer you. Are you asking? The answer was no. And that was 1996. And when I ask that question today, the answer is still no. But at any rate, that's when I discovered referral selling. And I thought, oh, something could be about this. So I need to do what I call my feet on the street research. And I asked salespeople and sales execs I knew, do you like to get referrals? That seems like a dumb question, but I had to hear it from them. Mm-hmm. And then I asked the second question, do you have a referral strategy, a system, a methodology with a strategy, with metrics, with skills, and with accountability for results? The answer was no in 1996. And oh, you can guess the answer today. So that's how it started.
So here's what's interesting about, Joanne, here's what's interesting about this is in 1996, the answer to your 2 questions was no. So here we are, it's 2023. And the answer, unfortunately, is still no. So what do we do about it?
You know, it's a gap. And that's what we're going to talk about today, I think. What do we do about it? Mm-hmm. So I just want to put a stake in the ground here. And It's my point of view. I don't think anybody should ever have to cold call. And that means cold outreach today. It's not just the phone, it's email, it's social media where we get blasted. And it doesn't work. So, you know, I always look back to sales management because somebody's making them do it. Right? Why do I get all these emails? Oh, you hadn't seen my previous email. I mean, it goes, they've been doing this for years. And so people do what they're accountable for doing. Mm-hmm. And as long as that continues and they don't focus on referrals, that's what we're up against. And none of it likes it. One day I get like 110 junk mails. Mm-hmm. And I hear that from everybody. They're really sick of that behavior because it's not selling from the heart. You know, it's push, push, pitch, pitch.
Yeah, it's not selling from the heart. It's also not selling smart on top of that. I mean, just, you know, ending up in that junk pile of hundreds of LinkedIn messages and emails and spam phone calls. My phone rings now. It says this is probably spam. I mean, this is, you know, it's not even just being smart. This is almost a on one level, an issue of survival as well. And so prospecting through referrals is, I love this perspective of there's no such thing. There shouldn't be any such thing as a cold outreach anymore. Can you unpack that a little bit more for us?
Well, what would you like to know?
Well, let's contrast, let's think here together about, cold outreach. We know that's, you know, we would define that as someone that we just haven't really put any thought into, right? There's just like, we got a name, got an email, boom, let's fire a shot, right? Let's blast something towards them.
I agree. And I say it's cold. Mm-hmm. If the person doesn't know you and is not expecting to hear from you, mm-hmm. that's my definition. And so it could, again, it could be cold in any manner whatsoever. And there's a lot of variations today. In fact, when you talked about your phone, I still have a landline. Do I ever use it? No, because that's the number I have every place. So if somebody's calling that number, I know it's a cold call. Most 90%, 99% of the time, I have my cell phone and my email signature. But of course, people need to write to me and I write back in order to get that. So I don't give my cell number out. That's it. Just makes it really simple.
So flipping this into just thinking about this and in terms of warming this up and referrals, and here's what I absolutely love about this is, since for 25 years, very few, if no companies have actually adopted this as a strategy, it seems like for all of our friends who are sales professionals listening in and those who are sales leaders, adopting a referral strategy for your business is an incredibly smart thing to do. Mainly, if not for there's dozens of reasons, but one of the biggest ones is nobody else is doing it. Like this is an incredibly smart thing. So if you would coach us through what referral strategy could look like or should look like for our friends in sales who are listening in.
I will, but first I want to share why referrals are so great. What the first one is, and a lot of people don't think about this, it's our biggest competitive differentiator.
Yep.
Right? Think about it. So you get a referral, you get an introduction, you get the meeting. And so it shortens the whole prospecting time, but you're in there and able to build relationships while your competition is still knocking on doors or call, whatever they're doing that's not working. Mm-hmm. And so that's one. It's huge competitive differentiation. And you get the inside track because this person knows you. You've been introduced by someone the person knows and likes and trusts. So you have a different conversation. That's probably the biggest. And you don't have to spend how many touches. I don't know. It keeps changing. 8 to 12 touches to reach someone. Mm-hmm. It's one. And then there's no cost to referrals. So those running sales organizations and running companies, you're not having marketing costs. You do have a cost, however, and here's the cost. You must have company note cards. You must have real stamps to put on an envelope. And a thank you note needs to be written from the salesperson to the person who introduced them, to the client who's ever involved. That's it. So your cost is the cost of the stationery, the cost of a stamp. The cost to the client is the results they get from working with you. And everybody's concerned about budgets and costs today. So those are key. And what's additional key, I don't know which of these is more important actually, but the conversion rate. So I always do these quizzes all the time. Everybody I work with, what percent of the time when you get an introduction to the person you want to meet, does that person or that company become a client? It used to be 50%. It still is a lot of the time, but I'm telling you, a lot of the time it's 70%. And I've even had people answer 90%. So there's nothing that comes close. The other thing is you're getting those qualified leads in the pipe. So you're running a sales team. You don't worry about smoke and mirrors because you know it's real because this person's gotten an introduction and had the conversation. So those are all the just unparalleled benefits of referral selling.
I love it.
And typically what happens when, with what I've seen sales leaders do, a couple things. One, they tell their people to go get referrals. That's about it. And the other thing that just boggles my mind, in many industries, the salesperson sells a deal, hands it off to customer success, and then moves on, right? And all those relationships are left on the table. I've even had sales leaders say, salespeople should not be prospecting. They should be prospecting for their own leads, right? I forgot that part. Prospecting for their own leads. I just don't understand that, because as salespeople, we have the relationships. Mm-hmm. And when we've closed a deal, we've talked to more than one person typically.
Yes.
Right? And we know when we've clicked with people. It's not everybody, but I imagine there must be three or four people that we've connected with during the buying process. Mm-hmm. All those people we can ask, and they're glad to help. They just don't know what to do. And when we ask and ask the right way, we get an introduction. They can happen two ways. Depending on the size of the company, the person can introduce her counterpart in another division of the company, or someone she knows outside the company in her role. So everything just spreads and spreads and spreads and spreads, and that's how it goes. But it's not happening.
Oh, well, it's so beautiful. And I think this is a great moment right now. And this is such an important and powerful conversation we're having. In just a few moments, I want to come back and I really want to peel back the layers of how do you build a referral strategy, and what should we be thinking? One of the features in our show, which I'm so excited about, is every week we have one of our Selling from the Heart friends and champions submit a video about what it means to them to sell from the heart. And this week we're hearing from our friend at Salescast, Chris Decker, has such submitted a video. We love Chris, and I love his heart. He's going to share with us what it means to him to sell from the heart after a brief word from our sponsors. And then we'll rejoin this incredible conversation with Joanne Black.
I'm thrilled to introduce to you a revolutionary tool that will change the way you understand yourself and others. Our partners at the Y Institute have created the Y.OS Discovery Platform, a powerful tool that in just 10 minutes can help you uncover your core motivations, how you bring them to life, and what others can expect from you. This is more than just a self-awareness tool. It's a game changer for coaches and those who want to help their clients reach their full potential. If you're a coach or a sales leader, go to whyinstitute.com and look for the Why certification. We'll put the link in the show notes. When you reach out to the Why Institute, let them know you heard about it on Selling from the Heart, and you'll be on your way to helping your people discover what drives them. Don't just take our word for it. Go to whyinstitute.com and see the powerful impact the Why.OS discovery can have on your life.
What does it mean to sell from the heart? Well, I'm going to go off of page 20 of Selling from the Heart, and I like this. Stay true to who you are. Be genuine. Be authentic. Get to know yourself. Be curious and ask a ton of questions. Always ask for help. Just be the real deal. The real you. I would like to add that through communication in sales, that love actually needs to be a part of it. And I'm going to bring an example from the Bible. So 1 Corinthians 13:1, this is what it actually says. It says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. What that means is, if love isn't a part of my message, if I'm not loving people well, it doesn't matter how good my sales tactics or skills or listening or whatever that happens to be, it's literally just noise. So we want to be our real selves. We don't want to be just noise. Love is the answer.
I love it. Oh, I love that, Chris. That's
Chris
so
is
good.
Such a great guy. And this is a great conversation, Joanne, and thanks for having with us. And as I was listening to what you were saying, I wanted to bring this into the forefront because you brought something up in our conversation just recently around how many people are in the buying process, whether that number is 3 or whether that number is 5 or whether that number is 8, just depending on how many people are there. Is I believe salespeople have ample opportunities to connect to these people because part of the referral process is referral networks. And I think this is also, you know, such a vital part of someone's referral strategy is if we can connect to these people, we start building relationships with these people. Based on title, they all hang around with people just like them that we can tap the referral networks. I think this plays into your conversation as well.
It does. And I also marked something in your book, page 75.
I love it.
About a true sales professional doesn't rely on anyone else to help them prospect or add to their pipeline. They must prospect themselves. And there's more after that, but go to page 75 if anybody wants to learn Larry's wisdom.
Thanks, Joanne.
You're welcome. Well, yes, there are many people in the process. And there's another question people ask me, when should I ask? Now, some people say when we close the deal, when we sign, that's good. Others say, no, you know, we have to wait till we implement and they get results. Well, the fact is you're too far away from the buyer at that point. You can also ask before you sign the deal. You know, a lot of times during the buying process, if we're good at what we do, we guide the client, we listen to them, we make suggestions. And some of the suggestions, they're just so grateful for. And we can ask then, because we know when we have a relationship, and it's all about trust. Mm-hmm. So there are good times to ask, and most people just don't. They just wait and wait and wait. And then it's like, no, it's too late.
Yeah. Yeah. I love this. And I'm just thinking along the lines of some salesperson listening in right now and thinking, okay, what should I be thinking in light of all this? What should I be thinking in terms of developing some type of strategy or set of habits in my sales cadence around asking for referrals?
Well, the first thing is you need to put a stake in the ground and say referrals are going to be your number one outbound prospecting approach, because we all get inbound, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. You know, clients come to us, want more, they send other people. What's not happening in companies outbound, which is a measurable, predictable referral system, a methodology, because referrals drive revenue. I think those are the most important three words, yeah. at least in my business vocabulary. And so that makes it even weirder that people aren't adopting it. But strategy is simple. So I don't believe in binders and 10 pages and whatever. You can have three bullets. I just want to know what is the outcome you expect as a result of working a referral system. Now, for some people, it's a number of new clients, could be revenue, could be opening up a new territory. It could be opening up a new vertical. Mm-hmm. Everybody's different. But the outcome is what you need to focus on. Because if what follows you don't do, you're not going to get the outcome, right? So that's one. Two, there has to have to be metrics. I believe in activity metrics as well as results metrics. So the results are what you get, whatever you said the outcome was. Well, that's a lagging indicator. You can't manage to that. So activity metrics are key. And the first one is, who am I going to ask this week? And if you don't ask, the other activity metrics don't matter. So yes, who am I going to ask? That's one. And then two, how many referrals did I receive? Three, how many referral meetings did I conduct? Now, you'll know after that meeting whether this is a prospect or not. Even if it's not, do not miss the opportunity to ask that person for a referral, because at that point, you know, they trust you. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure you've given them advice and things they can use during the conversation. Mm-hmm. So you can ask them. So that's three. So if it's not a client prospect, then ask. If it is, then based on your conversation, you could put it in CRM as a qualified lead. Right? Mm-hmm. So those are the metrics, but start with the results and then go back and add the activity metrics, because you can measure those. And it needs to be weekly. By the way, the minimum is one. You have to ask at least one person a week. And that's really not enough. So that's the metrics. Then the third is, referral selling is actually a skill. It's a behavior yep. change. And for many reasons, why we can't just point and tell people to go, right? Here's the fact. 99% of the people are uncomfortable asking for referrals. It goes in any culture, any age, any gender. It doesn't matter. I've had guys tell me they're just not comfortable asking and they don't know why. So I have brought that into every one of my client engagements. And a lot of the reasons are, what if they say no? Yeah. And it would be devastating because, okay, you have the relationship. Is there something they didn't like about me? What did I say? They don't like the color of my hair. I don't know. All this stuff goes through our head. Mm. There's this discomfort. I might be intruding on a relationship. It's aggressive, like the used car salesman. It feels desperate. Because here's the thinking. If I were really successful, I wouldn't have to ask. Well, we know that's not true. But sure. But these are all perceptions, and I treat them as real. So we do a lot of work to get over that. And a big part of it is learning to ask with confidence. So those are part of the skills. is getting over that discomfort and then having a step-by-step process for how to ask. And probably the most important is accountability. Because if you're not accountable, nothing will happen. And when I'm working either with individuals or companies, we have accountability metrics. And by the way, if you're in a company and you're managing a team, those need to link to your KPIs, because that's what people are accountable for, right? Mm-hmm. And so all of that's the package. And also beyond that, what you're doing is building a referral culture. Now, I never used to use that word because in the consulting firms I work for, they did culture work. It took forever, cost millions of dollars. I said, I don't want that translation. I mean, the millions would be nice. No, I don't want that. I really don't want that. But it's not that at all. And I found this definition that I love. Culture's what happens when people aren't looking. Right? It becomes the way we work. And it starts with the salespeople. And lately, clients have been including their customer success teams because they also have relationships, different ones.
Sure.
But you don't know who people know, right? Yeah. Until you ask. And so that's the system. And it works. 27 years later, it still works.
and you know what's so good about this, Joanne? It's not that complicated. I always say this stuff, that it's not rocket science. If you're developing the relationships like you say you have with your clients, why can't you just ask for help? And that's what just boggles my mind all the time, is salespeople, sales leaders, sales teams will say, we got great relationships with our clients. Why don't you just ask for help? Why don't you just ask for some help and have them help you grow your business? You're helping grow their business. You're bending over backwards for them. Why can't they help you? Why don't you just ask? And it's just...
Well, yeah, there's lots of reason, including the discomfort, right?
Sure.
But also, help used to be a word that seemed uncertain to people. You know, I'm asking for help. That means, you know, like the ringing hand, that must not be good. I don't know, wonder what they're going to say. Now, during the pandemic, that's what we did, right? We called clients, we talked to them, we wrote to them, how can I help you? Hmm. And we did stuff for free because we really wanted to help. So since then, help has not been one of those words that feel soft. But I see that changing back to the way it was because we're really not operating that way. If we were, Larry, it would be they'd follow your book, right? But that's been the barrier. It feels weak.
Yeah.
Right. It seems simple. Referral selling is simple. It's not easy.
What a great conversation, Joanne. This is just so incredibly practical and helpful. And I really, really am grateful you've shared time with us today. As we wrap up, how can people get more Joanne Black in their life and take this conversation further?
I would love to talk to you. I think the easiest way to send me an email, Joanne, J-O-A-N-N-E, at nomorecoldcalling.com. And I'll send you my calendar. And we'll just set up time to talk. And if you can tell by this conversation, I love referrals. I love sharing. And I always give you tips. And the other thing, please invite me on LinkedIn with a personal message, please.
Did you hear Joanne on the Selling from the Heart podcast?
That's right. That's right.
Yes. Yeah, say, you know, you were in the Selling from the Heart podcast and you want to connect, and also click the bell on my profile so you get notified when I post. So there's just great reasons for us to chat. And I would love to do it because it's my favorite topic.
I love it. Well, Joanne, thank you so much for sharing time today. This has been incredible, and you sure are an inspiration, and we really appreciate you here at Selling from the Heart.
Thank you.
Oh, thanks, Joanne.
Awesome.
Oh, Darrell.
Man, so much right in that conversation. And I'm challenged to the core today.
Well, you know, Joanne said something. This is revenue generating activities. Is yes. Referrals drive revenue. Mm-hmm. Guess what? Relationships drive referrals.
That's right.
And the stronger you build your relational network, the stronger you build rock solid relationships. I believe you can ask for referrals. Follow Joanne's strategies and principles. But again, this is simple stuff, but like Joanne alluded to, it's not easy to deliver consistently with discipline over and over and over again. But this is the fast track to conversations.
I think you're absolutely right. And as we talk about at Selling from the Heart and the Trust Formula, you've got to combine authentic relationships with disciplined habits. So this stuff doesn't just magically happen. There's got to be some discipline behind it. And I encourage you to take Joanne up on her offer. What a generous offer. Thank you, Joanne. And thank you to everybody in the Selling from the Heart community. As we're here at the beginning of summer, this is the time that you need. Joanne talked about it, accountability and encouragement and all of that. And you can find that right here inside Selling from the Heart. Our community at the Selling from the Heart Insiders Group meets every Friday, and we chat throughout the week in our private social network. And if you want to connect with other like-hearted sales professionals, come join us. We'll give you a free pass. You can test drive it, sellingfromtheheart.net/free-pass. We'd love to see you. I know it's going to become a huge encouragement, inspiration, and equipping time during your week. Larry, I'm just excited right now. The book is at barnesandnoble.com. People are pre-ordering the book. We've got stuff coming up in the fall that we're getting ready to roll out. This is just such an exciting time here at Selling from the Heart. And just a huge thank you to everybody in the Selling from the Heart community who's an ambassador for this movement of authenticity in the sales profession.
Yeah, I'm super grateful to everyone. And as we just wrap this up, Darrell, is we're all doing this together. Together,
that's right.
We're creating this. We're creating the momentum. We're all standing up and we're all making the sales profession even better than it is by bringing authenticity and heart to the forefront.
So thank you for being you. And until next time, keep being genuine, keep being authentic, keep building trust, ask for referrals, and most of all,
sell from the heart.